We would like to welcome you to worship this morning. As you can see, it's one of those where we're running a little bit behind. So we'll hit the ground running. It is great to be worshiping with you this morning. And we would just like to welcome you here to First United Methodist Church, Bella Vista. If you would, will you bow your heads in prayer? Gracious God, we thank you for this day and we thank you for this time of worship. We pray that you would send your spirit upon this place, that it would wash over us, and that we would be renewed and refreshed this morning. It's in your name we pray. Amen. I believe Jaimie has a couple of announcements that he was announcing this morning that I will go ahead and pass along to you. The first being that tomorrow at 3 o'clock, if you are available and around and would like to help, we will be moving everything out of Becker Hall. So if you are here and would be able to help with that next week, Becker Hall will not be in use. We will be getting new carpet. That is the original carpet. And so it's over 25-ish years old, I believe, and so it's time for some new, and that is made possible thanks to some memorials and different things, and so we are grateful for that, and so we will be moving everything out tomorrow at 3 o'clock. And then, if you have a lot of fun, tomorrow at 3 o'clock, on Friday at 2, we will be moving it all back, and so you will have a second opportunity to help with that if you're available at that time. And then following the fun of moving everything back, you are all invited and welcome to come to the trunk or treat that we will be having Friday. And that begins at 5:30 and is from 5:30 to 7:30. If you'd like to volunteer in some way by providing more candy or a trunk or helping set up or do something, please, there are sign-up sheets in the narthex if you'd like to sign up, or you could certainly call the church office and let us know that you are wanting to help and be a part of that. Or you can just come and witness all of the little children running around and having a good time, whatever you feel led to do. We would just a couple of opportunities there for you this next week that I am letting you know. And now I'll invite Jan forward as she brings the rest of the announcements.
Good morning. I'm Jan Lowe, Minister of Congregational Care. I want to welcome everyone here this morning. If you're a guest with us, we especially want to say thank you for worshiping with us. And if you're a guest for the first time, we hope that we can give you some more information about our church that may make you just want to come back again and again. So you can help us make that happen for you before you leave this morning if you will go to the narthex beyond those doors, and there's a desk there where you can give us your name and address. When we have that, later this week, someone will stop by your home and they will drop off a mug to say thank you for worshiping with us. That mug is going to contain information that tells about the many ministries, the many ways that we have in this church to serve our Lord, to serve people in our community and beyond, and to serve one another. I hope that sounds good to you. In the meantime, we ask that everybody enjoy the fellowship that is present here today. I believe that attendance pads have already been passed. If someone new has come into your row, pass it one more time. When you sign your name or when we see your name on there, we know that you were here, but it also helps us to figure out who wasn't able to be here, and that way we can just do a better job of staying in touch with our church family. So thanks for helping us with that. If you will open your bulletins to ministry opportunities and events, I've got just a couple of things that I would like to mention to you. One is veterans photos. Many of you have been here, and you've if you've been in the service, you've already turned your photos in and know that on November 9th, when we celebrate Veterans Day, that we will be showing all of the photos of the people who have served in the military. And it's very meaningful for all of us to get to do that. If you've not been here, or if you haven't had an opportunity to turn your photo in previously, please do that now. And we do need all of the photos in the office by this Friday. The office closes at 1, so please have them turned in by this Friday. Want to tell you or remind you that there is going to be an organ performance by Faith Freeze this afternoon at 2 o'clock here in the sanctuary. We do hope that that you will have an opportunity to come and just enjoy that performance this afternoon. On November the 2nd, next Sunday at 6 o'clock in the evening, there is another group that will be performing The Sounds of Hope. So read about that. I haven't heard them, but I've heard that they are just absolutely wonderful. So we hope that you will come to that as well. God bless and thank you. And mission message right now from Sandy Fitch. Thank you.
Good morning. Jan forgot me in the tradition or in the contemporary service last month, so now she's nervous. Mission of the month this month is in gathering. The Saturday before Thanksgiving has become an annual day of service for Arkansas Methodists. On November 22nd, from 9 a.m. to 2 p.m., persons from across the conference will come together to celebrate the 37th annual in gathering. What is in gathering? I can see you scratching your heads and asking that question. In-gathering is a supply drive to benefit United Methodist Relief Ministries in Arkansas and worldwide. Held at the Arkansas Rice Depot in Little Rock and sponsored by the Conference Board of Global Ministries, this year's in-gathering will include a devotional time, a midday fellowship meal, and lots of work organizing donations for storage and transport. United Methodists will deliver, sort, and pack relief supplies to help those affected by disaster, both here at home and around the globe. Now this year, our very own Chet Campbell and Daryl Botchin have volunteered to collect supplies from all over the Northwest District. They'll go from Harrison to Russellville in a big old U-Haul truck and pick up supplies that have been gathered by United Methodist churches to go down to the Arkansas Rice Depot. They'll collect everything from flood buckets to birthing kits to school kits or the supplies to go into those kits. I did this run last year and I'll tell you, it's a trip. The funds collected through our congregation will go towards helping those relief efforts here in Arkansas and around the world. Thank you.
Thank you. And God includes us in the story that we tell. And we were excited in the second service to have new persons join with our church family. Ted and Linda Ivy have become church members, and Rick and Rose Taylor. And they're joining in our story that we're telling about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. God is good. And all the time, we welcome you here. We're so thankful that you've joined with us in worship. We greet those around you and help us to make sure everyone is made to feel welcome this morning. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Okay, I realize that I don't talk to you before the anthem very often, except in extreme cases, and this is one of those. We need your help this morning. We need to enlist you to help us sing the anthem. Now, I know there are many of you sitting out there right now who have secretly nursed all your life a desire to be in the choir. Well, today is your chance. You notice in your bulletin, our anthem this morning is an arrangement of When the Saints Go Marching In. When we get to the last verse, I'd like for you to sing the, actually it's the first, it will be the words for the first verse. So if you all know the first verse of When the Saints Go Marching In, you can do that while the choir goes off and does their thing. So I'll let you know when the time comes.
When the new world is revealed, when a new world. Reading the scripture, Dalton Dell. He's one of our youth members, and in a little while, you'll have an opportunity to see him on the silver screen as well.
Good morning. Our scripture reading is from the book of Malachi 3:17 through 18. Listen to the word of God. They will be mine, says the Lord Almighty, in the day when I make up my treasured possession. I will spare them, just as in compassion a man spares his son who serves him. And you will again see the distinction between the righteous and the wicked, between those who serve God and those who do not. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
As we prepare for the ushers to come forward, let us examine our hearts and give generously in service to our Lord.
Thank you.
Creator God, we praise you, for you have made each of us with our own special gifts and graces. Every breath we take, our very lives are a gift from you. Gracious God, we give back ourselves and these gifts to you for your ministry. Use them to your service, multiply them, and build your kingdom with them. We ask all this in your Son's precious name. Amen.
Together we sing hymn number 707, the hymn of promise. This is part of our service in which we will offer our time of remembrance for those of our church family that have gone home to be with the Lord during this year. I invite you to join with us as together we sing. I invite you to be seated. We invite you to join with us in a time of remembrance for those of our church family that have been a part of us, who have worshiped with us, who have shared their love with us, who have introduced us to Christ, who have offered his influence to us. And so today we're remembering these persons. And some of these persons you will know. And some of these persons may be unknown to you. But part of the story of the First United Methodist Church of Bella Vista, part of the story includes these persons that we will name today. So I invite you to look at the screen, and you'll see their faces, and to hear their names, and to remember them as the bell is sounded. I invite you to remember Wynonna Anderson. Arlene Beeks, Vern Bladen, Bobby Cox, Bill Detlison, Nancy Devan, Joanne Drake, James Jim Fox, Pauline Gowing, Doris Graham, James Jim Hamilton, Vicki Ann Jones, Marvin Marv Mickelson, Michael, Mike, Patrick. Pat Mayer. Jim Pruitt. Juanita Reed. Patricia Pat Reed. Elizabeth Liz Scarf. James Jim Shannon. Albert Snyder. And also we remember Bonnie Snyder. Dorothy Spring. Robert Bob Tony. And yesterday I had an opportunity to participate in the service of Bonnie Watson in Iowa, and we remember Bonnie. Yvonne Wright. And Esther Youngman. Now all the candles are lit but one. And so I invite you to remember those that are precious and dear for you and your life. And to remember our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that He experienced death so that you and I may experience life that is eternal. And so Pastor Zach lights the last candle. I invite you to join with me in a prayer. It will be presented for you on the screen. It's also printed for you in your bulletin. Will you join with me as together we pray? O loving God, for all your servants who have finished their race and now rest from their labor, give us grace to follow the example of their steadfastness, faithfulness to honor and your glory through Jesus our Lord. Thank you.
Let us continue now in a time of prayer as we lift up joys and concerns this morning. In celebration of their 61st wedding anniversary, October 25th, Bob and Shirley Kennedy have made a donation to the Mission of the Month, which this month is First United Methodist Church of Bella Vista. The pink rosebud is in celebration of the birth of Evelyn Georgia Antoine, daughter of Dylan and Ashley Antoine, and sister to Emery. A white carnation is in memory of Pat Meyer, who passed away Sunday, October 19th. Her memorial service will be held here in the sanctuary Saturday, November 15th at 11 a.m. Another white carnation is in memory of Arlene Beeks, who passed away on October 23rd, and her service will be in Maryville, Missouri tomorrow. If you would, continue to be in prayer for Sybil Heifel, who has been moved to the Bradford House. Linda Bryce, who is continuing to recover from a stroke and is at the Mayo Clinic. In Highland Healthcare, we have Harriet Williams, Norma McLean, and Dawn Thompson as she continues to rehab from her broken hip and hip surgery. Just pray for her continued recovery. And you'll notice Helen Randolph printed there, but Helen has left Highlands Healthcare and is now back home at Concordia. You'll see several others there in need of healing touch, and we ask that you would take this list home with you and pray for it throughout the week. Lift these names up in prayer that we might join together as a body in prayer together. There are more exhaustive prayer sheets, all concerns that we have been made aware of throughout the week. And normally you pick those up as you leave. Someone is standing at the back door handing those out. That has changed a little bit. Those prayer concerns are now hanging on one of the wooden columns out in the narthex as you leave. If you would like to pick those up, we would invite you to do so and take those home and be in prayer this next week for them. Also, if you find yourself over in Becker Hall, there are some hanging at the back of Becker Hall, and then there are some as you leave the side entrance there of Becker Hall hanging up as well. So three different locations for you, depending on where you come in or go out from the church. We ask that if you would like to please pick one of those up and take it home and be in prayer for these folks throughout the week. As we continue to pray for churches throughout the community of Bella Vista, this week we would ask you to be in prayer for the Highland Christian Church, be in prayer for their pastors, their leaders, their congregation, all those that they may find themselves ministering to. We ask that you would lift them up in prayer. If you would, let us join together in our prayer song. Eternal God, we take comfort in knowing that you are here for us in our time of need. Through these concerns that have been lifted up this morning, through those who are facing illnesses or heartache of some kind, we lift them up to you this morning. Those that are on our hearts that haven't been mentioned this morning, we lift them up to you as well, praying that your will would be done, that your name would be glorified through each and every one of these circumstances. And gracious God, we give you thanks for the praises and the blessings that we have to lift up this morning as well. We give you thanks for new life, for birth, as we have celebrated the birth of a new baby, and as we prepare to celebrate the births of a few more babies. The Hickmans will give birth tomorrow at some point, and we give you the thanks and the praise, and we also give you the thanks for new life through you, that our old life has passed away and that we are a new creation in you, and what a joy that is. We ask that this morning, as Brother Jaimie brings the message to us, that you would speak through him, that he would speak the message that you have placed on his heart this morning, and that we would have the ears to hear it. We give you thanks for the gift of your Son, that he came to this earth for us, that he was willing to go to the cross for us, that he was willing to go to the grave for us, but that the grave did not win, that he rose again and he ascended into heaven for us. Remember these things now as we join together in praying the prayer he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Today we're continuing our sermon series, Face to Face. as we find ourselves face to face with God and as we seek to be face to face with others for our Lord. And in this past week, I hope that you either picked up an envelope that looked like this last Sunday in worship, or that you received one in the mail. If you did not and you would like one, if you'll contact the church office, we'll make sure that you get one. If you're visiting with us and you'd like to know about it, we'd love for you to have it. In that packet contained a catalog that looked like this. Our face-to-face stewardship journey catalog for 2015. There's over 90 ministries that are listed in there that you're invited to become a part of, and just simply take time to read over the definitions of those ministries and the expectations, and then you can fill out your dedication form here, how you would like to serve, and bring that back next week with your face-to-face financial commitment card for 2015. Well, next week, I invite you to bring both of these forms back completed, to spend time in prayer this week, considering how you will complete them, and offer them next Sunday as a dedication before the Lord with us in a special time in the service. Last week, we had several presentations that were given by persons involved in ministries of this church to invite you to be involved in ministry. And some of you here were able to attend those meetings and share those times of fellowship, and some of you were not. And so we wanted to help you to be there for those who were unable. And what we've done is we have put those presentations on our website. If you'll just go to the first page of the website and click on the top link, you will be taken. And they're broken down into different talks. So if there's only a certain area you want to listen to, congregational care, just click on congregational care and you'll hear the presentation that was made there. They were very gracious to videotape all of it, even me, when I did not think I was being videotaped. So skip over my part, because I didn't know I was on camera when I did it. Or if you would like a DVD, we also have DVDs. You can pick this up. Just stop by the office when you leave. Sign one out. We've made a whole bunch of them, and we'll just ask you to take these home. Review them, and when you're finished with the DVD, bring it back so we can share it with someone else, and that would be important. Today, we're thinking about service, what it is to be in ministry, what is it to be in service for the Lord. And we're going to read together this morning from Romans, the 12th chapter. We're going to add a verse to what's listed there. We're going to read verses 1 and 2 and 3 and through chapter 8. I'm reading out of the NIV translation, and maybe you've brought your Bible from home and it's a different translation, or if you'd like to follow along in the Pew Bible, I invite you to do so. But I invite you to join with us as we share in the reading and the hearing of God's holy word. In Romans 12, we read, "I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, as holy and pleasing to God." And then we're told that this is our spiritual act of worship. "Do not be conformed any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And then you will be able to test and prove what God's will is, His good and pleasing and perfect will. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the measure of faith God has given you. Just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ, we who are many form one body, and each member belongs to all the others." Do you hear that? Each member belongs to all the others. And then Paul helps identify the different areas of service and ministry that you and I are called to be involved in. We have different gifts according to the grace given us. If a man's gift is prophesying, let him use it to the proportion of his faith. If it is serving, let him serve. If it is teaching, let him teach. If it is encouraging, let him encourage. If it is contributing to the needs of others, let him give generously. If it is leadership, let him govern diligently. If it is showing mercy, let him do it cheerfully. This is the reading and sharing of God's word. Thanks be to God. And so together we are come. And together we know that we have an opportunity to be in service and ministry for God, to God, and with others. It's an important thing to be face-to-face with the Lord. I'll tell you the story this morning about a man named Bill. And Bill's not a part of this church family. And so if there's any Bills here, rest assured. This Bill was out walking one day. It was later in the afternoon. He was out walking. It was his normal pattern and routine daily. There was a biting wind, and so he was kind of walking briskly, but yet he was still enjoying the day, when suddenly his normal routine was disturbed by the sound of screams in the distance. He could hear a voice, and the voice was desperate. It was desperate pleas of help. It was life-threatening cries. And so Bill, as you and I ultimately would do, he reacted to it. And he listened for the voice again, and he ran towards the voice. And as he ran, as with the best of his ability to get to the voice, fear gripped his heart. And thoughts of what he would find seemed to cloud his mind. And ultimately, the voice took him to the shore of a lake. And Bill looked out on the lake and he could see a body. And by this point in time, there was no more sounds of a voice. And Bill jumped into the water and he swam out to the body, and it was a young man. And he lifted his head up out of the water and he cradled him, the head, with his body to keep it out of the water. And he was able to swim back to shore, where he turned the young man over and he positioned his body in a proper way so that he could offer mouth-to-mouth resuscitation to the boy. And he breathed and he offered the resuscitation. And finally, the boy began to breathe. And there was such a sigh of relief in Bob's heart. And he pulled out his phone and he called 911. And help came. Now here's my question for you this morning. Which part of Bill's body was most important for the success and for the survival of this young man's life? Which part? Were the ears the most important part because they heard the screams? Or was his brain the most important part because he could interpret the voice? Was it his adrenaline gland who pumped enough energy that he was able to offer a successful rescue attempt? Was it his legs that allowed him to run? Or was it his arms that he used to swim? Or was it his hands that he used to hold the boy's head out of the water so he could breathe? Or was it his mouth that he used to give mouth resuscitation? Or was it the breath that was contained in him that he breathed into the young man so that he could breathe? It's kind of hard when you think about it. Which is the most important part of Bill's body for the success and the survival of the life of the young man? When you think about it, none of the particular parts of the body were more important than the others, were they? Needed all the parts of the body working together in order to provide, in order to give life to a man who needed to survive, needed to be saved, needed to experience new life. It took all the parts of Bill's body working together for that to happen. And that's how it is in the body of Christ, the church. You and I are called. We are the body of Christ. And it's a privileged thing to be called the body of Christ and to know that we each have a form and a function and a place that God has created for us. And that none of us is a
favored over the other, but we're all the apple, we're all apples of God's eye. And he loves us all equally. And so we're all important in the body of Christ, and we all have a place to serve. We all have a place in the body. Well, this morning I want to introduce you to some of the parts of our body here at First United Methodist Church in Bella Vista. Some of our youth. You'll hear Dalton Dale, who read scripture for you. Sydney Hannah, Tiffany May, and Devin Presley. And there were so many others that Troy interviewed. But we couldn't show you everyone, or, you know, you might not get to hear me preach, and I know you'd be sad about that. And so so we've just culled out a few of them. So I want to introduce you to these younger members of the body of Christ.
It's really helped me grow as a person and kind of realizing how much God has impacted my life.
I've been able to do so many things for the community. That feeling of doing things for others, it's really touched me and changed me, I think.
The youth ministry has just been so great because we always meet on Wednesday nights and it's always consistent. You always feel loved by all the people here. You feel accepted. The people here mean so much to me.
Over the summer, we went on a youth mission trip to San Antonio, Texas. That feeling of being able to help out and do something better, and do something good for others, I really like that feeling.
I really would miss this ministry if it didn't exist anymore. I look forward to coming on Wednesdays, and I'm so bummed when I can't come on Sundays because of band or other activities that requires me to travel, and I just miss it. Like, I would utterly miss getting to see my friends every Wednesday night and getting to have this experience and listen to Mr. Hansen talk about God and getting to learn new things out of the Bible that I didn't know. I have been here since I was 5, and I've grown up with some of you, and you guys are so loving, and it's just the church creates a vibrant and such a meaningful place for worship, and all the people are loving and they're willing to talk, and I have many, many opportunities to expand my faith here at First United Methodist Church and grow with God. And I'm just so glad that I am able to call First United Methodist Church my home and my solid foundation. All the ministries here, acolyting, greeting, pack-a-sack, all just have made me be able to learn new things, learn and meet new people, and just expand my faith.
I honestly can't wait to see everyone on Sunday mornings. That's like my favorite thing in the world, is waking up and driving to church on Sunday and getting to see Mr. Hansen and Rod and everyone in the mornings. It's so wonderful.
I've been crying so much ever since she left me out of that. And so has all of us up here, right? David and Rod got mentioned and we didn't. But see, their lives being touched. And the youth find their place in service, and they find their place in ministry, and they want to be a part of the body. And so I want us to think about what it means to be a part of the body. And we're going to focus on Romans 12 this morning to do that. This is really a practical section of Paul's letter to the Roman believers. It's really where he engages them and encourages them to be in ministry and be in service. And in New Testament language, you can almost use serve and ministry in an interchangeable way. Both basically mean the same thing. And we understand that the role model for being in service or ministry is our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. For he came as a servant. He identified and he disclosed fully, both in Mark and in Matthew, that he, as the Son of Man, did not come to be served, but to serve. He fully tells us, I came as a servant. And his service would be to give his life as a ransom for many. To give his life to aid and help and strengthen life through his life. And so, throughout Scripture, throughout the writings of the Apostle Paul, you and I are introduced to Paul, and in turn, Paul introduces us to other people that find themselves in service and in ministry. And Paul uses Romans 12 to help us to find our place in service and ministry. He tells us we're all different, but yet we're all a part of the same body, and we all can serve. Some of us can encourage, some of us teach, some of us are involved in leadership, and the list goes on of the offerings that he speaks to us about. See, being in ministry, being in service for the Lord, it involves being face to face. It involves God and it involves others. There are three factors in order for our service and ministry to really be a true Christian service and ministry. One is it involves offering our service to God as an expression of our relationship, as an offering of our worship and dedication. It's offering whatever it is we do to the Lord. Now, at the bottom of your bulletin is kind of, we've been providing just some small facts about the church each week. And there is the list there, just two things. One, about our office angels. Office angels are persons that serve in volunteer ministries in the office during the weekdays. And they do any number of things. You cannot believe all the things they find themselves doing. Answering the phone, folding letters, bulletins. Sometimes they have to count paper clips. You know, they do all kinds of things. They make sure that you get a newsletter. They made sure that you received every member in ministry catalog. They do so many things. And as of September 30th, look how many hours they've given in service in ministry. 1,152. That wasn't done for their own good. That was done for the good of others, and they gave their service to the Lord. Now, I have said in other service, and I'll say it in this one, it doesn't mean you have to be an angel to be an office angel. It just means you have to be willing to be in service, because you're going to deal with a lot of us that aren't angels when you come and you serve us in that way. And one of the other expressions that we find ourselves involved in new ways of ministry is the other fact that's printed for you in your bulletin. And that is, never before in the history of First United Methodist Church of Bella Vista have we had four women pregnant at the same time. Have we, Wayne? You would know. You've been here longer than anybody. We've never had four ladies pregnant. If we had been, it would have been truly an immaculate conception. But we found ourselves in new forms of ministry. You know, occasionally we find ourselves in with a person with child, but lately, we just had a baby born, Evelyn, and tomorrow the Hickmans are having their baby, and then we've got the Pittmans over here, who she's fanning because of that baby, and then the Morgans are expecting a child. We find ourselves in new ways of service, new forms of ministry also that we've never been involved in before, and that involves others. Service and ministry involves God, and it also involves the believers, and it involves the non-believers. And so together, we find our place and our role in serving God and in being in ministry to people, believers and non-believers. In the Sermon on the Mount, chapter 5, verse 13, Jesus tells us what we are to be. He calls us salt. And we understand through his teaching that we have a role and responsibility as salt to flavor this earth with the glory of God, the love of Jesus Christ, with the power and the knowledge of salvation that is found in him. That's our role.
That's our responsibility. And so in order to do this, we have to find ourselves in places of ministry and service to indeed fulfill what our calling is through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And as we find ourselves in places of ministry and in places of service, we will discover that we're able to flavor the kingdom of God with God's love to touch people's lives intellectually, physically, emotional, and spiritually. We're able to do that. And far from our way, any of our ways of thinking is the thought that God would use us. But He does. He uses all of us. Our gifts don't have to be extreme gifts. Our gifts can be shared gifts, but we use those gifts for the opportunity to serve the one who has served us through sending His Son, who is Lord and Savior of our life. So I bet you have a burning question. And that burning question, after you have looked over the catalog and after you possibly listened to the DVD, might be, so how can I discover where I am to serve? How can I discover the ministry that I really think is right for me? I mean, how do I know where my place in the body of Christ is? Well, that's why Romans 12 is so important for us in these first eight verses. It helps us to really think about that and just discover and discern where we're supposed to serve. First, the Apostle Paul tells us in verse 1 that we are to dedicate ourselves to God. He says, in the words I've already read, I appeal to you, therefore, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a holy and living sacrifice, acceptable to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. So as you and I seek to discover and discern our place of service and ministry, one of the first steps we have to take is to dedicate ourselves to the Lord. And the second thing we have to do is really to take an inventory of our life. And what are the competing distractions that we find in our lives today? Verse 2 tells us, do not be conformed to the ways of this world, but to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. And so we have to spend time thinking and evaluating. What is it that really vies for my time that keeps me from being all I can be for God? We as pastors and you as the body of Christ, we find ourselves in a different culture today in this world. It's not the same. It's not the same version of ministry that I offered to serve in 25 years ago or more. It's not. We find ourselves in a culture that offers so many competing opportunities in people's lives. Even one of our youth said, you know, when I have to miss church because of all the things she does, we're in a different time. And so even in our personal lives, we really have to think about, what are those competing things in our life that vie for our time that really distract us from being in service and in ministry for the Lord? And the third thing we really have to do, as you look over this catalog and as you think about service and ministry beyond the catalog in your own personal lives, so we have to evaluate our gifts. I mean, what is it that each of us has to offer? And we all have something to offer. If our mobility is limited, we can offer the opportunity to be involved in a prayer ministry. If we've got plenty of time in our life, we can find ourselves serving in other areas. It's not so much about the amount of time or the ability. It's about the opportunity and rising to the occasion to fulfill what God has called you to do. And then we have to realize that as you and I seek to find ourselves in service and ministry, it's not about us. And that's another distraction in our culture that seems to grip us. Too often we think it is about us, and it's not. It's about serving God and serving others. It's about being face-to-face with God. It's about being face-to-face with others. And so we find ourselves working with other people. in union, in cooperation. Verse 4 and 5 of Romans 12 says, "For as in one body we have many members, the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, one body of Christ, individually, members one of another." We all have different giftings that we can serve and we can complement with each other as we work in service and ministry with and for one another. And the last thing we have to do is just be willing to take that leap, that step, and activate our gifts and our service in our ministry. Having gifts, the Apostle Paul tells us in verse 6, having gifts that differ according to the grace given us, let us use them. So what is it that you have that God has blessed you with that you can use in service in this kingdom that can touch and transform lives, that can offer life and survival and hope for someone that may found themselves in an unwanted place? God wants to use you. He wants to use you in a powerful way. And He can use you. And it is our role and responsibility as your church family and as the members in the body of Christ to offer this to you. Not to make you do it, but to offer it to you. And then it is each of our individuals' responsibility to respond to God's calling on our life. So I invite you to spend some time this week thinking about it, being in prayer. Where will you serve God? Father, we thank you so much that you involve us in your kingdom purposes and that you use us in all our inadequacies. You use us. And you take what we offer and you make it adequate. When it's offered in a right heart, in a right spirit, and right motives. So, Father, we ask you today to direct us and to help us and to guide us in all that we do in service and ministry in this church and so far beyond in our families and our workplaces with our neighbors as we find ourselves face to face with each other. This is the prayer that we offer, and we do so in the loving name, the saving name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And together we say, amen. This morning we invite you to respond to the invitation to be involved in ministry and to be involved in service. Together we'll sing, "Here I Am, Lord." It's hymn number 593. If you'd like to become part of this church family like the Ivies did this morning and the Taylors did, I invite you to join on transfer of your membership from another church family. Or if you have never professed your faith in Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord of your life, we invite you to do so today. If you've never been baptized, to experience baptism and to know that there's a place for you in this fellowship. If you'd like to be prayed with, it would be our privilege to pray with you as well. Or if you simply want to be in a time of prayer at the altar is here for you. I invite you now to join with me and I invite you to stand and sing and offer your hearts and your response to the Lord through singing, "Here I Am, Lord."
Thank you. by the
Thank you for being here today, and as you responded, you said, "Here I am, Lord." And so in this week, I pray for you that you will meet those opportunities to be in ministry, in a service for the Lord. And we look forward to coming back to worshiping our Lord and our God together this week. If you can help us move furniture this week for Becker Hall, we'll expect you at 3 tomorrow and 2 on Friday, and then we're going to have fun at Trunk or Treat Friday night. Come and join us. Go in the knowledge our God is a God who's faithful. Faithful in our past. Faithful in our present. He's faithful for our future. Our God is faithful. And remember, don't simply come to church, but what are you and I called to be? Be the church. God bless you. Have a great day.